In this video, we're going to be discussing the chemical methods of sterilization and disinfection. We start with the Food and Drug Association classification of chemical disinfectants. So depending upon their spectrum of action, they are classified into three groups: high level, intermediate level, and low level of disinfectants. So high level, or also called as chemisterilants, are able to kill bacteria, fungi, viruses, mycobacteria, and also spores. And these include ethylene oxide gas, plasma, and aldehydes. ETO, plasma, and aldehydes are high level of disinfectants. Next are intermediate level of disinfectants, where we are not sure whether they kill all the spores or not. And halogens and phenols come under this group. Finally, we have low level of disinfectants. That is, we are not sure whether they kill all the viruses, mycobacteria, and they do not kill spores. And low level of disinfectants include the alcohols and the surface acting agents. Now, amongst all these chemical A groups that we have classified, only two of them are present in the are active in the presence of organic matter, and they include the phenols and aldehydes. Please remember that. It's a very often asked question. Phenols and aldehydes are active in the presence of organic matter. So I'm just repeating the three chemical groups belonging to the various these groups, these categories. High level include aldehydes, ETO, and plasma. Intermediate level, phenols and halogens, and alcohols and surface acting agents belong to the low level of disinfectants. So we start with alcohols. Basically, for our exams, you're supposed to remember what is their mechanism of action, what is the concentration, and where are all they used. So mechanism of action is they dehydrate cells, they disrupt membranes, and they cause coagulation of proteins. Examples are ethyl alcohol, isopropyl, and methyl alcohol. Ethyl alcohol, so always remember, regarding alcohols, they are always used in a concentration of 60 to 80%. So 70% of ethyl alcohol is often used as a skin antiseptic. Isopropyl alcohol, which is more bactericidal, less volatile than ethyl alcohol, is often used as a hand disinfectant. And methyl alcohol is used for killing fungal spores in biosafety hoods. Next is aldehydes. These act by alkylation of proteins, or rather various residues in proteins like amino residues, carboxyl residues, and hydroxyl residues. And they also damage nucleic acid. Examples of three aldehydes which are used for sterilization are formaldehyde, glutaraldehyde, and orthothaldehyde. Now, formaldehyde is generally available in a concentration of 37 to 40%, and it is used for the sterilization in the form of a gas, which is called as fumigation of rooms, chambers, OTs, biosafety hoods, wards, as well as sick rooms. So we generate formaldehyde gas or formalin gas. Next is duckering, which is the disinfection of animal wool and animal hair or bristle. It is also used for preservation of animal specimens and cultures, but its disadvantage is it is highly irritant and toxic. Next aldehyde that is used is glutaraldehyde. We all know it as Cydex, in a concentration of 2%. This is used for the effective sterilization as well as disinfection of heat-sensitive instruments like cystoscopes, bronchoscopes, laparoscopes, centrifuges, anesthetic equipment, endotracheal tubes, corrugated rubber tubings, dialyzers, etc. Now, here two things have been mentioned: sterilization and disinfection. Remember, if we are aiming sterilization, at least 6 to 8 hours of dipping in Cydex liquid is required. But if we are aiming just disinfection, just 20 to 25 minutes is adequate. Now, shelf life of a Cydex solution is 14 days. So you can use it again and again for about 2 weeks. The next aldehyde that is used is orthothaldehyde, used in a concentration of 0.55%. The use is absolutely similar to Cydex, but what advantages it has over Cydex is it is stable at a wide range of pH. It is less volatile, hence almost is non-irritant, better odor, and it has better mycobactericidal activity. Next chemical agent is halogens. They are basically oxidizing agent. They cause the oxidation of essential sulfhydryl residues in enzymes and proteins. The chlorine compounds which are used are chlorine tablets, which are used for water disinfection like water supplies and swimming pools. Next is household bleach, which is used, which is available in a concentration of 5 to 6% of, and it is basically 5 to 6% of sodium hypochlorite. This is used for to disinfect floors in a stock dilution of 1:10, as well as for infectious spills disinfection. Iodine compounds which are used are tincture of iodine and povidone iodine or betadine. Tincture of iodine is 2% iodine in 70% of alcohol, used as antisepsis. And iodophores, which are betadine, here these are called as iodophores because the iodine has been coated onto a neutral carrier molecule for a prolonged action, residual action, and the neutral carrier is polyvinyl pyrrolidone. It is used in a concentration of 10% for skin antisepsis. Moving on to phenolics, which are coal tar derivatives. Their mechanism of action is they disrupt cell membranes and they denature proteins. 5% of phenol, 1 to 4% of cresol, and 2 to 5% of lysol are the phenolics. These are used for disinfection of ward floors. They are used in discard jars in laboratories and for disinfection of pans. They are never used for skin antisepsis because they are skin corrosives. Now, if we modified the phenols, we chlorinated them, they lose their corrosive action to the skin. So these can be used for antisepsis. So chlorinated biphenolics, though they are less active and more readily inactivated by organic matter, they can very well be used for antisepsis. Examples of these are hexachlorophene, chlorhexidine, chlorxylenol, and triclosan. Dettol is 10% of chlorxylenol and Savlon is a mixture of chlorhexidine and cetrimonium bromide, which is a surface acting agent. Moving on to surface acting agents, these lower surface tension and thereby disrupt microbial membranes. Primarily two types of surface acting agents are used, cationic and anionic. Cationic surface acting agents are the quaternary ammonium compounds, cetrimide and benzalkonium chlorides. And soaps are the anionic surface acting agents. Moving on to two newer methods, ethylene oxide and plasma. Mechanism of action of ethylene oxide is alkylating agents, very similar to aldehydes, and it is a highly active chemisterilant. Remember, it belongs to the high level of disinfectants. It is used in the form of a gas, and it is used for the sterilization of heat labile or moisture sensitive articles like beddings, rubber gloves, plastic disposable gloves, syringes, petri plates, prostheses, complex apparatuses like heart lung machines, respirators, and dental equipment. Ethylene oxide, one cycle of ETO sterilization has three steps. Preconditioning, that is, we are going to put the objects in the ETO sterilizer and expose them to high humidity and maintain them at a desired temperature. That is preconditioning, which takes about 8 to 12 hours of putting in them. Next is introduction of the ETO gas, which again takes about 4 to 8 hours. And finally, post-condition is done to remove the toxic ETO vapors. Fine. So it's a very long cycle time. The complete cycle time takes as long as 18 to 24 hours. Now, there are two types of ETO sterilizers, those which work in a cold cycle and those which work in a hot cycle. Cold cycle meaning the temperature in the ETO sterilizer is somewhere around 37 to 44 degrees Celsius, and hot cycle is when the temperature inside is around 55 degrees Celsius. Efficacy testing of an ETO sterilizer can be done by using the spores of either Bacillus globigus, which is a pigmented variant of Bacillus subtilis. So hence I've mentioned Bacillus subtilis var niger. That's the other name for globigus. Or we can use the spores of Bacillus atrophius. Disadvantages of ETO sterilization include the gas is irritant to skin and mucous membranes. It is inflammable, has been shown to have carcinogenic potential, and is toxic. So prolonged exposure can lead to neurological disturbances and cataracts. Hence, if we say exposure monitoring is required for ETO gas, that is absolutely true. Moving on to plasma sterilization. Plasma is essentially an excited gas. What gas we are using is, it is hydrogen peroxide. So VHP, which is mentioned out here, is vaporized hydrogen peroxide. This plasma is generated by applying energy in the form of electromagnetic radiations in the form of either radio waves or microwaves are applied to the gas particles. This leads to the generation of toxic oxygen radicals, which disrupt the metabolism of microorganisms. One cycle of plasma sterilization is taking just 60 to 75 minutes. The following steps are there: vacuum phase, injection phase, let the gas diffuse, so diffusion phase, then plasma phase when you're going to apply electromagnetic radiation, following which venting out the gas, and the temperature maintained in a plasma sterilizer is somewhere around 30 to 60 degrees Celsius. Vaporized hydrogen peroxide is a non-toxic method of sterilization of heat-sensitive plastic and surgical instruments. But there is a warning that you can't put liquids, neither can you put in cellulose materials like paper or linen inside the plasma sterilizer. Remember, how do we test the efficacy of plasma sterilization? It is by the spores of Bacillus stearothermophilus. It is absolutely same as that of autoclave, Bacillus stearothermophilus. Moving on to some special topics which are asked on sterilization and disinfection, we get questions on Spaulding's classification. Spaulding divided all medical devices which are used for diagnosis and treatment of patients in hospitals and laboratories into three groups. This basically gives us a guideline as to the degree of disinfection or sterilization required for various medical devices. There are three categories of medical devices. Critical meaning, this is a device which enters the normally sterile tissues of the body or it enters the vasculature. For example, surgical instruments, IV cannulas, cardiac catheters, orthopedic implants, cardiac implants or pacemakers, all of them will come in the critical category. So all surgical instruments, IV cannulas, etc., implants, pacemakers, etc., will come under the critical category. And such devices should be completely sterilized before use. Next category is semi-critical, that is a device which comes in contact with intact mucous membranes and does not penetrate ordinarily sterile tissues of the body. So these devices include, so semi-critical would include the various scopes like we use, cystoscopes, bronchoscopes, or GI endoscopes, esophageal manometry tubes, or thermometers which come in contact with mucous membranes. These devices should at least receive a high level of disinfection, except for thermometers, in which even intermediate level of disinfection will solve. Lastly, we have the non-critical category, which these are devices which do not come in come in contact with intact skin, and these include stethoscope, ECG electrodes, bedpans, hospital furniture, etc. These devices just require low level of disinfection. Lastly, we come to how do we test the efficacy of disinfectants? Basically, you are supposed to remember what is quinol coefficient. In phenol coefficient calculation, we are comparing the efficacy of the new disinfectant with that of phenol. So how do we calculate the phenol coefficient? What we do is we prepare series of dilution of phenol and we prepare series of dilution of the new disinfectant. Then we are going to add a standard amount of either Salmonella typhi or Staphylococcus aureus to each dilutions and we incubate them. At 5 minutes intervals, samples are drawn from each dilutions and inoculated on a growth medium. And then we find the highest dilution of phenol as well as of the new disinfectant that kills the bacterium at 10 minutes but does not kill the bacterium at 5 minutes. And that value or that dilution we are going to use for calculating the phenol coefficient. So that dilution of the disinfectant is divided by that dilution of the phenol. So let's say 1:1000 dilution of the new disinfectant killed the bacterium in 10 minutes, but not at 5. And 1:100 dilution of phenol killed the same organism in 10 minutes, but not at 5. So how will we calculate the phenol coefficient? It would be 1:1000 divided by 1:100. That would come to 10. Fine. So this indicates, so calculating the phenol coefficient will tell us, we will find that disinfectants which have a phenol coefficient more than 1 are found to be more effective disinfectants in comparison to phenol. So less than 1 indicates this disinfectant is less efficacious in that in comparison to phenol. Now we can calculate the phenol coefficient by two methods, Riedel Walker method or Chick Martin method. Out of these methods, the Chick Martin method is to be preferred because it is more realistic. Because along with the organism Staph aureus or Salmonella typhi, to simulate normal conditions, realistic conditions, we also add 3% of sterile feces. So this is basically simulating the presence of organic matter. Fine, so prefer the Chick Martin method. Next test is Kelsey-Sykes test, which just gives use done to carry out, find out which dilution of the new disinfectant we should use. So we find out the ability of the new disinfectant to retain its activity in the presence of increasing load of organic matter. So basically we are calculating the capacity of the disinfectant. So remember, Kelsey-Sykes method is used for finding out the dilution to be used. Next test is in-use test of Morel. This is a test which is used to find out the detect the contamination of disinfectants which are presently being used in hospitals and laboratories. So how we do this test is we prepare a 1:10 dilution of this disinfectant in a diluent which contains an inactivator, which is going to inactivate the activity of this disinfectant. Then we take 10 drops each of this dilution and add it to 2 nutrient agar plates, 10 drops each, 2 separate 2 nutrient agar plates. One of them we are going to incubate at 37 and one at room temperature for 7 days. And if we find that 5 or more colonies are forming on either plate, that means our disinfectant is contaminated, so it should no longer be used.